Mother Agnes Mariam of the Cross is spokesperson for the Catholic Media Center of the Diocese of Homs, Hama and Yabroud in Syria. She's also one of the main representatives of the Mussalaha Reconciliation Interfaith Initiative, which has the support of all Syrian religious communities. She has been a fearless and indefatigable proponent for Syria's persecuted. Mother Mariam, welcome. Let's go back to the crisis in Syria when it first started. Were you presuming to take this tragic path?
Well, yes, because even though in the mainstream media it was only a classical uprising, and what was going on was between peaceful protests and fearful oppression. The reality is that very soon after this beginning, there was a third part which was infiltrated and composed by unidentified armed gangs that were spreading terrors between the civilian population and the security forces. These facts have been ignored by the press and by the consequently the public opinion during months, but they were basing for an ongoing violence, progressively shifting to become sectarian violence.
How did you find yourself involved in this crisis? Were you surprised?
Well, in the beginning I was not involved. Mm-hmm. Because political stances are not ours, we are spiritual. Our vocation is to pray and to work on spiritual and cultural fields. But I was questioned as the superior of an important monastery in Syria about my position concerning, and also my point of view concerning the events, the ongoing events. This was done in at the end of March, the first month of the uprising. I was hesitating, dubious, because, you know, I don't have any incidents on the ground. But they insisted. It was a French Catholic NGO. And then I made my research, and I questioned many people.
Yes.
And I wrote an article that was heavily spread everywhere under the title of Syria in the Flood of Disinformation. In this article, I was predicting a sectarian strife. After this article, because it raised some questions, I decided to invite, with the Catholic Information Center in Lebanon, reporters to come and make their job to see what was going on. I had to accompany five of them to Homs and Qusair to translate. And that's why I became witness. Yes. And witnessing a third part of the conflict that was ignored by everybody.
Yes.
Pulled me on the scene, you know.
Yeah. That leads me to this question, Mother Agnes Mariam. You said the pictures and videos in regards to the sarin chemical weapons incident in Rif Damascus and in Ghouta are prefabricated, and you are confirming to have evidence to prove it. What evidence do you have?
Well, I wrote those evidence on paper in a 50-page study that was remitted to the delegations in the 24th Assembly of the Council of Human Rights in Geneva. Then, of course, it was also remitted to the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights and to the Commission of Inquiry to Syria. In this study that is online, you can find it on script. I give the evidences of the forgery of some videos nominated, authenticated by the U.S. intelligence community. You know, they authenticated 13 videos to present them to the Congress as evidences of the victims, of the reality and of the victims of the sarin gas attack.
Did they take them on board?
Pardon?
Did they take these videos on board?
I don't know what you mean by on board.
I mean, did they believe it?
Of course, they authenticated them. It means they believe it. So I was contacted by the survivors of the massacres of Latakia, which occurred in the 4th of August, and they recognized some of their children in the victims of the alleged chemical attacks. So I was tracking the children in those videos and having a very acute visual perception, because I work as a restorer of icons and other cultural items. I definitely noticed a lot of discrepancy. This conducted me to deepen my observations. Yes. And today I have, as I told you, written about those evidences, but I found more evidences that will be online very soon.
Okay. You stress that what happened in Ghouta is a crime against humanity and a violation of all international conventions. And you called also on the international community to stand united to stop violations of the new barbarians in various parts in Syria. Was your invitation well received?
Well, I don't know if it is my invitation, but at least my desires are being now fulfilled after the vote of the British Parliament and consequently the position of the American Congress to impeach the strikes on Syria, and the proposition that was introduced by the Russian Federation to dismantle the chemical weapons in Syria. This means, you know, a very wide door that has been opened to a final settlement based on dialogue, on negotiation, a political settlement. We work in Syria for reconciliation and to prepare, to pave the way for this kind of settlement. Yes, I can tell you that my desires are being fulfilled.
Mother Agnes Mariam, can you tell us the story of this tour and how it was organized?
Well, you know, after the evolving of the situation, after the end of the strikes, we have had a lot of interest coming from many partners all over the world. You know that the choice of a peaceful, non-violent way of addressing events and uprisings is widely spread, and you have many activists all over the world. So I have been invited by many organizations in the United States and also here in United Kingdom and in Ireland to give facts, to talk about achievements of reconciliation in Syria on a popular and civilian ground. And that's why, you know, I am touring the United mm-hmm. States, and I will be here in United Kingdom for 1 week, going also one day to Ireland.
What is the importance of the UK for you? Why did you choose the UK?
Look, the UK is the mastermind of the Western world, I have to tell you. United Kingdom is always giving the orientation. And you see how, with the vote of the British Parliament, it changed everything.
Yes.
So, in England, they take their time, but finally they will orient the public opinion. I have to say also that I admire very much BBC and the whole English papers, English media, and English newspaper, because in the whole history of the crisis in Syria, I think they were the most fair.
Going back to the Christians in Syria, what is the status of Syrian Christians in this phase of the crisis, and how do you explain the fact of targeting them in their villages and churches, especially Ma'loula, by killing their priests, abducting their religious figures on different occasions?
You see, maybe to alimenta sectarian war, the media will highlight from time to time what is happening to the Christian. Sometimes they will ignore it. When it began in Homs, it was totally ignored. What I want to tell you is that globally in Syria, everybody is in danger. And the massacres that occurred to others' communities have been totally ignored. For example, the massacre of the Alawite in 11 villages in the mountain of Latakia was totally ignored. It was a Human Rights Watch after 1 month that decided to go and see, but we had already documented and brought the attention of the Commission of Inquiry in Syria. So Christians, as other population in Syria, are targeted because it seems that the goal of the ongoing conflict is to establish a one-color, extremist, fundamentalistic rule under a religious cover, but it has nothing to do with real Islam, so that to pressure the population and deprive it of any possibility of reacting. You know, under the title of religion, you can apply violence, but with justification. And the international community, I regret to say it, has offered a huge coverage for this, and has also ensured an impunity for such acts of barbarity, of barbarism. That's why all the red lines have been bypassed, and a new era has begun to rise in Syria that is much more violent and much more repressive and much more terroristic than the era that they want to bypass for a better way, for a better life. So Christians are also paying the tribute of this extremism.
What is the role of the church in this case? Are you working towards an international conference, for example, for the churches to be united, to include the Catholic Church, the Orthodox Church, the Anglican Church, since you are here, in order to face the new threats the Christians are facing in Syria in particular?
Well, you know, there have been many initiatives. Lately, our Patriarch Gregorius III Laham was here in the United Kingdom, and he has been seeing many personalities in the political and spiritual realm. He has also appealed for a kind of permanent council of all the churches in Orient, to be able to face the events. It is true that maybe more is necessary. Today in Rome, the Pope has invited all the patriarchs of Orient to make a panoramic view on the situation and take the right decision. It's time, I think, and whatever is done to secure unanimity on the event and a common position will help to strengthen the ongoing cause of peace and help people to be reinserted in Syria. You know, you have more than 7 million people that are displaced. We need a strong united action And our initiative for the support of reconciliation in Syria also is directed toward such a goal.
Syria is well known of being a country model of a coexistence in the Middle East between its different races, its different ethnic groups, religions, and confessions. Do you think this country is still able to retain this this feature?
I am sure that Syria, first of all, did not lose this feature. It has been a little bit persecuted or aggressed for this feature, but the Syrian people, the majority, and it is the silent majority of the Syrian people, continue to choose fiercely the party of pluralism, of diversity, of conviviality, in harmony, in a national harmony. And this is one of the, as you say, the best qualification of the Syrian society. I appeal to the world to protect the diversity in Syria, the freedom of religion in Syria. That was, you know, a feature of the Syrian society. I appeal the international community to ban any religious extremism, as is banned the anti-Semitism and apartheid. Religious extremist is a real plague for the society. It endangered the stability of life, of common life, and it is a threat to the dignity of the human, the humanity. We cannot, we will not accept the ongoing development of religious extremists in Syria and in the Levant.
Mother Agnes Mariam, you were exposed to fierce online criticism. They called you infidel, they called you seeking to fuel sectarian strife. How do you explain this campaign against you?
Well, you have a few, it's not a lot, it's very few persons that are not happy with our role of reconciliation. You have the warlord and those who are benefiting of the crisis. There is a proverb in Arabic, you divide to reign. It means that when we come to be a mediator and a link or a bridge between different factions, there are people that are not happy, and they don't have any motivation to reject our work, so they defamate or they deny what we are doing. I don't have any idea what can be their intentions. I have never answered to their defamation because, as I tell you, it represents nothing. No, I am very happy wherever I go. I was in Poland 3 weeks ago. We are very well known. Our work is appreciated by the basis, but also by the decision makers.
In a response to one journalist question, you said that I am an independent nun and I am not subjected to anyone. What do you say to accusations that imply that you are cooperating with the Syrian intelligence?
Well, you know, they went to say that I pretendedly asserted that my information concerning the ongoing violence in Homs and Qusair, when we revealed the presence of the unidentified armed gang, they pretended that my information, that I said, I would have said, that my information comes from the intelligence services. You know, it's a real contradiction. How shall I affirm something which I do not need? I don't need any information from anybody because I was present by myself. And I have records about what I have seen. And the information I have produced was not transitory or something like in one place for one time. It was an ongoing violence, and until today we are seeing it face to face. It has developed enormously and became a real cancer that is eating all Syria. So you know, those people, I think that this blog in Le Monde who produced such an affirmation is himself an intelligence blog, and he would like to discredit our honest work to highlight dangers that are putting the life of many in danger. Yes.
Mother Agnes, you are known among people from all social classes and with different political opinions through your travels in dangerous areas in Syria. You met with families who lost their loved ones, and you did not hesitate to launch several appeals to save the Syrian people. May I ask, where do you get your courage from?
You know, I am a believer. I have discovered Jesus Christ in my life, and he was the first to go to the cross for love. He said there is no other or bigger love than to give your life for those whom you love. So it is, I wouldn't say easy, but it's our fate to show our love by bypassing fears and going through dangers. And I am happy to do this action because I would like to be in solidarity with the Syrian people, go and see what others cannot see, to be a witness, and then have an idea about the situation so that I can answer the best way on a humanitarian and social level.
In 2011, a group of foreign journalists followed you in your tour to areas of tensions and conflicts in Syria. What is the outcome of this journey, and how did people receive you in these difficult conditions?
Well, we have approached this team before. They didn't follow me. I followed them. I invited them with the Catholic Information Center to visit Syria, to be able to build a position or to build a knowledge about what was really going on. And going with them once, one time, one day, to Homs and Qusair, I became with them a direct witness. So the outcome of this visit was that it was the first time in the history of the crisis that the existence of the unidentified armed gang that were aggressing the civilians and the security forces was highlighted. And it provoked a real tsunami when we achieved our press conference in Lebanon. I think that the echo was hugely positive, and we had some voices threatening us because they wouldn't like that this artificial violence would be disveiled, you see. Mm. And this means that they were in a way or another implicated in this violence, at least in preparing or in ignoring, in hiding this violence until it will achieve its goals, that was first to paralyze the civilian life, second to divide the Syrian society on sectarian plans, then to introduce a new approach of the revolution based on extremist and fundamentalism.
Mother Agnes Mariam, are you getting enough humanitarian aid to help the Syrian refugees or the injured civilians? And also, can you tell us more about the mobile hospital project you are striving to get fundraised?
Look, the situation in Syria is so tragic that nothing is enough. We have 7 million of displaced people. More than two-thirds of the civilian population are in need because you have a lot of jobless people, you have a lot of homeless people, you have a lot of injured people. So, and the infrastructure of the state have been completely spoiled. There have been a systematic destruction of the state resources, like municipality buildings, administrative buildings, schools, universities, hospitals, factories, pipelines, electricity plant. Even they wanted to destroy the Euphrates Dam, like, you know, to provoke a humanitarian catastrophe. So everything is destroyed, and this, you know, has generated a lot of needs. So it is never enough. We are receiving containers from many places, from France, Belgium, Holland. Now we will receive from United States, also from United Kingdom, from Australia. For this hospital, we launched it with the expertise of a Dutch NGO called Dorcas Aid. And this hospital is very precious because in some areas, hospitals, the public hospitals and also the private hospital, have been totally destroyed. So people are in need for medical care, and many of them are victims of the lack of medical care. So this we could achieve the financing of this hospital, and now it is in Homs. We decided to put it in the universitarian city, and the University of Homs gave us big place because it will become the nucleus of the universitarian hospital in the future.
How many mobile hospitals do you need?
We need at least four more. Those are the most needy, one for Aleppo, the other for Daraa. We need one for Deir ez-Zor and one for Idlib. This is, you know, the most needy because those cities are still a refuge for many people, and they are lacking of real medical care because their hospitals were destroyed.
Mother Agnes, what are the chances of completion of a national reconciliation among the various components of the Syrian people after overcoming the crisis?
Since now, before overcoming the crisis, we can tell you that a beautiful atmosphere of willingness and openness between Syrian people is a reality. And we have been witnesses of incredible moment of forgiveness and reconciliation in Syria. You have more than 3,000 volunteers in the National Mussalaha, in the National Reconciliation Initiative, that are touring everywhere in Syria, trying to tear down the walls of enmity between the diverse religious or cultural or ethnical groups, and building bridges. And so we have a lot of achievement in these fields. We hope that we after good time, we will get a national reconciliation to look at the future with a renewed energy and trust for the pluralistic composition of the Syrian society.
Do you have any special appeal to President Bashar al-Assad and the Arab Syrian army?
Well, my appeal to the Syrian officials and to the Syrian opponents and to the world is that the peace approach, the non-violent approach, is better than the violent approach. Of course, today we understand that terrorism and foreign fighters cannot be accepted in Syria. Yesterday, the Vatican issued a declaration done by Monsignor Mamberti, who is the number two in the Secretary of State. He is like the foreign minister of the Vatican. He said that the foreign fighters should be isolated and pulled outside Syria. And we consider that the best would be that they accept, and the people who finance them, the country who finance them, to stop their interference in the Syrian case and go back to their homes. Then there will be no justification for violence, and the Syrian people, in a non-violent way, will discuss, will dialogue, will negotiate, and will come to a global agreement. We really appeal for a non-violent settlement of the Syrian crisis, and also for the real implementation of the amnesties that the president is giving. Sometimes it is not applied fairly.
My last question to you, what do you expect from Geneva 2 conference if it takes place over the next months, as some expect?
I expect, and we as a reconciliation committee, we expect fairness in addressing the real choices of the Syrian population, who is ignored in its silent majority. So it is not enough that government representative and opposition, foreign opposition representative meet. The Geneva Conference should also consider the non-political agglomeration to give them voice. And this voice, I think, is the voice of the majority. But before Geneva II, I think that the international community should foster support and give the possible ground for the developing of the national reconciliation, because it is the best way to pave the route for Geneva II.
Mother Agnes Mary, thank you so much for your time. Thanks for watching.